in our first session on Noah's Ark, we talked about the fact that it was real and that the flood was global, and we looked at the evidence both from Scripture and from the world around us that sustains that conclusion. In the second session, we want to look at some of the objections that are often made to this story, why some have doubts, and then consider some of the account's claims that maybe it could still be on Mount Ararat. Often we're told that it's just impossible that all of those animals could ever be fit on this ark that we see described in Scripture. It's just not a believable story. And we referred, for example, to Ernst Mayr's estimate that there were about 1 million fossil species or animals that would have to have been accounted for on the ark. Well, I can see 1 million fossil species represented here, but what's the problem with this representation? Well, fish don't have to be on the ark, do they? Most of these animals live in the ocean, which doesn't surprise us because 70% of the Earth's surface is covered by water. And so we can, for all practical purposes, certainly by estimating, eliminate the majority of this and wind up with just 7,000, which are just over 7,000 land animals, which were specifically named as those which were destroyed by the flood. And then there's another problem with this. We're really not talking about the kinds of animals. We're talking about species of animals when we look at Ernst Mayr's estimate, one of the leading taxonomists. And species overemphasizes the problem. Kind was obviously broader than this. When we see how it's used in Scripture, the term kind is used to describe, for instance, fishes. There were many kinds, plural, and so it's narrower than the category fishes. But when we look at hawks, there are hawks that reproduce after their kind, singular, and yet there are many types of hawks, we could say. There are many species of hawks. It's a superfamily in biology, but one kind. And so maybe it's closer to family in our concept of biology, but I don't think precisely so. But at least in a general view, we can see that it's much broader than species, and the number of species would be multiplied compared to the kinds. But using the estimate of Ernst Mayr, which multiplies the problem, we see 17,550, and we of course have to multiply times 2. We'll allow for the fact that things are going downhill, unlike what the evolutionist would predict, more and more kinds, but I think there are fewer kinds. We'll say there were twice as many in the past because things are becoming extinct, which would give us, when we allow 5,000 clean animals, 7 each of those. That's just a gross exaggeration, but rounding it out to a maximum, outside maximum, of 75,000 animals that we would have to account for if we use Ernst Mayr's bloated estimate. A more reasonable estimate would begin with about 5,000 kinds, and this, according to some of the leading experts whom I have studied with on the subject, is probably twice as many. Well, it's twice as many as John Woodmerappe calculates in his book dealing with the feasibility of the flood. We'll refer to it later. But let's take 5,000 as a good, reasonable estimate of the number of kinds, not species, and multiply times 2. We've got 10,000 animals. We double it for animals that have become extinct since things are going downhill. That'd give us 20,000 regular animals, probably 1,000 clean. So we're looking at 21,000, let's say 25,000 that you have to have on the ark. Now, is the ark big enough to hold 25 or 75,000 animals? Well, not if we're considering the ark as one that looks like this. The Fisher-Price toy type concept of the ark is not anything like what we see in Scripture. It would be more like this. And here we see animals coming and going up the gangplank, and we also notice that there are dinosaurs there. And one of the questions that we always get is, were there dinosaurs on the ark? And absolutely had to be good evidence for it from several standpoints. Well, how could you get it? Well, look, you see, they fit well with the scale that we're looking at. We're talking about a vessel almost five stories high, almost two football fields long. There would have been plenty of it. And, of course, you wouldn't have had to have had fully adult-type dinosaurs. Actually, reptiles continue to grow all of their life, unlike mammals, which ossify the ends of the bones and stop growing. Reptiles keep on growing. You see an alligator that may be sexually mature at 3 feet, but grows to almost 20 feet. And dinosaurs did that, and animals, well, at least people, we expect animals, lived longer before the flood. And so we would have had great, great, great grandpas that would have been really huge in the reptile category, but God wouldn't have chosen those to repopulate the earth. He'd have picked the teenagers. Interestingly, we saw in Newsweek a few years ago a trackway reported in South Korea where scores of tiny milling brontosaurus the size of calves were reported. And so maybe we're looking at juvenile forms of dinosaurs that we're taking on the ark, or maybe young adult brachiosaurs that we see here. There certainly would have been plenty of room even for the adults. But evidence does demonstrate that the dinosaurs survived the flood. We go out west and we see the Anasazi petroglyphs here at Natural Bridges National Monument. Under one of those bridges we see the Anasazi warrior up over my head there, and then the snakes. But look beside me there. You see highlighted obvious brontosaurus-type creature. It's covered with heavy desert varnish so that it's difficult to see. But very obviously, they were seeing dinosaurs to do that. We have at least half dozen examples of that. We travel to Peru, and we see also evidence that the people there in historic times were seeing dinosaurs. In the Inca tombs, and we've been able to do some of the excavating there, we see here in one of the tombs, Inca burial stones, and on these stones were carved various scenes, perhaps from the life of the one with whom they were buried. And these stones, some of them very large, like this one in Dr. Cabrera's collection, though there are half a dozen other collections that we found in Peru all over the country. This large one depicts dinosaurs, as you can see, with the dermal frills on the back that we didn't know about until 1991. They were doing these at least 2,000 years ago down in Peru. Looking at this intricately carved stone, we see here a dinosaur with a man in his mouth dangling by the foot. And this large stone is about 3 feet tall, but very obviously depicting a dinosaur. Others not quite as artistic, various styles, various materials, types of stones. But no question about what is being depicted here. These are dinosaurs that were being carved on the stones. And likewise, in the tombs, we see the dinosaur motifs on their pottery. Here are the Moshi vases, very famous, well-known from 2,000 years ago. And dinosaur motifs are seen on the textiles that are buried with them, on the gold death mask that we see here. Notice on either side of the face, the huge teeth and the tail curving up over the back with the dermal frills on it. Dinosaurs depicted down in Peru 2,000 years ago, and so they had to have survived the flood. We go to Mexico and we see figurines from over 2,000 years ago, a collection of some 30,000 figurines in the Chipicoro culture. About 2,600 of them are of dinosaurs, which means they had to be seeing them. We traveled just 2 years ago to Cambodia, and there back in the jungles, the temple to Prom is covered with carvings, almost every square inch. This is a Buddhist monastery dedicated in 1186, and there in the carvings is a beautiful Stegosaurus. If you need more information about some of these things, that's available on our websites. We're just hitting the high points. But there are numbers of lines of evidence that show that dinosaurs certainly survived the flood. Interestingly, the emperor of China, according to Marco Polo, had dinosaurs that pulled his chariots. Certainly sound like something like a stegosaurus. When you read Marco Polo's description of it, we see him as a historian that we depend on in other areas. We kind of skip over this part of it. But was the ark big enough? Well, we see how many animals. To really know, we have to know how big the ark was. And most people have never sat down and put the pencil to it to figure out how big it was. It's just impossible. Well, how do you know it's impossible? How many animals? Well, I don't know. Well, how big was the ark? I don't know. But they're sure that there were too many animals to fit on the ark. Well, let's think about it. If we have a cubit at 21 inches, and that's about the middle of the range, which goes from about 18 up to 36 for the Royal Egyptian cubit, good evidence for thinking it was 21 inches. We'll talk more about later. Then we get dimensions that look like this, almost 600 feet, 2 football fields long, and over 50 feet high. Well over 2 million cubic feet would be involved. That's probably not telling us a whole lot, 2 million cubic feet, but we can relate that to 750 railroad cars. If you have to wait at the crossing for 750 railroad cars to pass, you're going to be there a while. That's the carrying capacity of the ark. If we use that analogy of the railroad car, we can get an idea of how many animals. First, you have to know what the average size animal is. We think of cows and horses as the big animals, the impressive ones, bears. But the actual average is much smaller than that. There are many more shrews and mice. The average, I'm told, is about the size of a cat. But let's double that. I think they were bigger in the past. That's another lecture. And use sheep as the average, and that helps because we know how many sheep you can put in a railroad car. You put 240 per average double-deck railroad car, and you're not allowed to put more than that in. That's the carrying capacity of that that space. That gives us 180,000 animals as a maximum carrying capacity for the ark, based on how animals are shipped across the country today. Now, I think they probably had more room. They were spread out further than that. Of course, over a year's period of time, they would need more room than when they're just shipped across the country. But this gives us a realistic way to estimate. Now, 80,000 animals. Now, let's think for a moment again about what we concluded a moment ago, assuming that kind is a species, and that's a ridiculously generous assumption, and using the splitters estimate, and Mayer would fit into the category of splitters instead of lumpers when he's talking about the numbers of species. You double the number for extinction, and you double the average size from cat to a sheep, and you only need 70,000 as an outside maximum to be carried, and we have the carrying capacity of 180,000. What do you mean it's ridiculous? It becomes ridiculous to object. Once you do the calculations, all would be accommodated in 42% of the ark's capacity if we use all of these broad maximum assumptions. 42% is all we need. Actually, if you have a more reasonable estimate of the number of kinds, you come up with all of them in 12%. 12% of the ark's capacity, which means with the three decks, you could have Mr. and Miss Noah. With the top deck all to themselves, you could have the food on the third deck and the animals all on the bottom deck and just drop the food down to them, which I don't think is the way it happened, but just to illustrate the foolishness of the objection that it's not possible. It's actually the atheist ridicule that needs to be ridiculed. They haven't put the pencil to it. They don't know what they're talking about. And if you want to look at all of the objections that have ever been raised in the past 100 years, you'll see a lot more information than you want. But it's all here in Noah's Ark, a feasibility study by John Wood Merapi, who spent years and years researching both the objections and the answers to those objections, and they're all answered. I don't think there is a valid objection to the idea this was a feasible story. And people who say it's not possible just haven't figured. They need to go look at the answers to their objections and see that John does an excellent job. Now, in the part that remains, we want to look at the question that we get often. Is it possible that it's still there? That is, the Ark on Mount Ararat. Well, this is something like 4,500 years ago. That's just not possible. That's ridiculous, Dr. Patton. You know this, you know, 4,500 years ago. I think what we're seeing here is this fairy tale concept, the Tooth Fairy, Santa Claus relegation of this story in the back of our minds. If this is really so, why not? We have no problem with these dates when they're ascribed to things often from archaeological finds. For example, I was recently at the University of Chicago, there at the Oriental Institute, looking at some of the finds. Here are papyrus shoes. Now, that's not exactly permanent type durable stuff, but we're told these things are from 3,200 years ago, shoes made out of papyrus. And also in the same exhibit, we see linen, which was from 3,500 years ago, and people don't blink at that. We see noodles, of all things, according to USA Today, found in China, 2000 BC. This is 4,000 years ago. This is pretty close to the time of the Ark, and you got noodles still preserved. Well, what about an ark that's covered with pitch, which is a preservative that's frozen in a glacier most of the time? That would be no problem if you can preserve then the noodles. If we were to find it, it would just be earth-shaking. Interesting statement made by Gilbert Grosvenor, who was the first editor of National Geographic. His view is very different from the present editor. But he says the discovery of Noah's Ark would be the greatest archaeological find in human history, the greatest event since the resurrection of Christ, and would alter all the currents of scientific thought. And I think that's an understatement. We think of the implications in geology, both physical and historical, from archaeology, from history, from zoology, from the humanities. There's hardly a discipline, biology, that would not be revolutionized by the realization that this is where all the living things came from just a few thousand years ago. Yes, this would be terribly significant. This is a picture of the greater Mount Ararat with the lesser in the background. It's a group of mountains. This is the one usually referred to and from which the various sightings primarily proceed. Mount Ararat, it's a spectacular mountain. It's impossible to photograph to give you the scale. It's some 3.5 miles high and may be the largest single peak in the world. Now, Mount Everest is obviously higher and other peaks, but it's 3 miles high when it starts. This one starts basically from sea level, actually a little bit below in a kind of a moat around it. It's a volcanic mountain that's kind of sunk a little bit since it originally erupted, but still proceeds from the plain 3.5 miles up. It's an awesome place and very impressive. Well, is it possible that it could be there? Why not just go look and see, we're often told? Well, it's not quite that simple. This picture doesn't show it 3.5 miles high. You just can't do that that well. It's a very rugged terrain. It's a volcanic mountain. It's loosely consolidated. The rock doesn't hold together well, and you can see it have boulders come tumbling down all the time. There are both physical and political challenges. We look at this map that shows us where it is in eastern Turkey. It's in an area that's been at war with Turkey for the past 15 years. The body count now is over 70,000. The Kurds think this is Kurdistan. Turkey doesn't agree with them, and they're killing each other over that and have been for at least 15 years now. This is the area in the eastern portion of Turkey. The Kurds are nice people. there are some rebels who are not nice people. They are vicious and murderous and would love to kill Americans to draw attention to their separatist cause, and this is a problem. And they're guarding the mountain. This is one of their hideouts, and maybe a major hideout. We're looking here at a picture that shows the interstate that leads to Mount Ararat. The mirror on the left is from a Volkswagen bus that was rented by some friends of mine who noticed that there were several bullet holes in the vehicle when they rented it, and unfortunately there were several more in the vehicle when they turned it back in. It's not a nice area of the world to be in. There are Kurdish wolf dogs, which are very vicious. There are mountain lions and bears and poisonous snakes, and it's not a real tourist destination. And as we suggested, the mountain is unconsolidated. The rocks tumble and fall. It's actually easier once you get up on the glacier. And of course, as you're camping on the mountain, the rocks tumble down. You hope not on top of the tent that you're staying in at the time. Ice climbing is the order of the day if you're going to get up to the glacier. It's just not as simple as it sounds. Just go look and see. But when we look back in history, we see numbers of ancient accounts of those who saw it. Josephus, one of the more famous Jewish historians, speaks of those who had seen it in his day that he interviewed. They saw it from the base of the mountain very easily. Berosthus speaks of those who, in fact, he claims that he saw it in his day, and yet those accounts dissipate and disappear. Did not appear again until 1840, when a huge earthquake opened a gash in the side of the mountain, and then we had a number of them, and then they have dissipated again. I think what we're looking at is an indication of the buildup of ice there on the mountain. We have propaganda that tells us all the ice is disappearing, but there are many places on the earth where it is building up. One very obvious place is in Greenland, famous for the Lost Squadron that crash-landed there. They abandoned the planes back in World War II. They came back 50 years later and found they were under 240 feet of ice. Difficulty finding them, but did, and then tunneled down through the ice and were able to remove them. But in 50 feet, the ice had accumulated to a depth of 240 feet, with, of course, thousands and thousands of layers covering these airplanes. Now, it's tempting to get on to another subject here. This kind of layering shows thousands and thousands of years, we're told, down in the Antarctic, but here we know you've got World War II airplanes at the bottom 50 years ago. This, though, is the kind of thing that appears to be happening on Mount Ararat. Back 50 years ago, 100 years ago, evidently this was not the case. Georgi Hagopian was one of the Armenians who lived at the base of the mountain, who barely escaped the extermination, virtually, of the Armenians who lived at the base of the mountain in 1917. He escaped to America. But living there in his early years, when he was 10 and when he was 11, traveled up the mountain, according to his account, with his uncle, who carried him up to see the Ark. His family, the people that he knew, were very familiar with the Ark there, and it wasn't seen every year. But when there was low precipitation during the winter and a hot summer, then it would be revealed, and they would travel up to see the Ark. He, together with Alfred Lee, produced drawings of what he saw as a youth. Of course, having escaped then to America and lived here till he passed away just about 8 years ago. This was the view in 1910 of the Ark as he saw it up on Mount Ararat. And notice the structure across the top. The Bible says the window, according to the King James, was finished a cubit and a half upward. Well, I'd always wondered about that. How can one window accommodate ventilation for the whole Ark? Well, if it goes all the way across, and one window here would be a baffle for the water as well as access for air throughout the whole Ark, then that would work. And it's finished a cubit and a half upward. That didn't make sense till I saw the picture. This view also shows this superstructure across the top. of a barge-like creature. Now, it doesn't look anything like the old master paintings, which depict ships that were designed to go places. This was like a barge, designed to carry things, not necessarily to go anywhere. Very efficient in its length to width proportions, the most stable configuration that we know of today. But this is the way Georgi Hagopian described it. He went there and saw it, according to his account. We compare that with another account. This is a drawing of a picture, the drawing made by a friend of mine, Dave Gumar, of a Russian photograph. And we're told that Russian aviators in the early 1700s were flying over and saw this sticking out of the glacier. Looks very much like what Hagopian drew. A rather crude drawing, but nevertheless very similar. They told this to the Russian Tsar. He dispatched a group of 50 soldiers up the mountain. They traveled up the mountain, stayed there almost 3 months, found it, photographed it, entered it, made measurements, and came back down. While they were up there, the Bolshevik Revolution took place. The Tsar was killed. All of the religious leaders were killed, and here they have pictures of the Ark. Most of them were killed. According to the account of one that we have interviewed that did survive, he came to America, worked in the oil fields in Oklahoma, and had a picture. He was one of the photographers, and he was not willing to show this picture publicly because of things that we found out going on there on Mount Ararat, that they found it. The Kurds there that lived on the mountain were guarding the Ark from the eyes of the infidel, and the 50 soldiers were necessary to ward them off while they were measuring and photographing. But they're very concerned that the eyes of the infidel contaminate this holy spot, and if they keep it pure, then this is where Muhammad is supposed to return. Anyway, he wasn't willing to show this because they would come after him, and he was afraid of them, and we've seen that such fears are not unjustified. But this is the picture of the picture, the drawing of the picture that he saw. This is a sketch that was drawn from photographs taken by George Green in the 50s. He was a petroleum geologist flying over the mountain, not really a religious person, not looking for the Ark, but sees this strange structure sticking out of the glacier, photographs it along with the other rock formations there when he's looking for oil, comes back home and shows it to some friends, and they ask what this is. He doesn't know. It's a picture of Mount Ararat with something sticking out of the glacier, and his friends were religious and very interested in Mount Ararat, and wow, maybe this could be the Ark. And it certainly is a drawing that looks very similar to what the other two eyewitnesses had seen. Earl Cummings, an Ark researcher, heard about this and went immediately to interview Mr. Green, who by that time had gone again to South America on a petroleum exploration for one of the oil companies. And there he was killed. It would appear that the Kurds found out about his photographs, as had Earl Cummings, and chased him down. They tossed him out of a six-story window. Nothing was removed from the hotel room except the pictures. All of his money and personal effects were still there, but he was found floating face down in the swimming pool. However, many of the friends of George Green had seen the pictures, and this is the sketch that they drew of the photographs that they had seen that then disappeared down in South America. Another account comes from Ed Davis, who was stationed at the base of Mount Ararat in World War II. He was a part of the Army Corps of Engineers. And here myself with Don Shockey on the right are interviewing him at length. Don Shockey has made 5 trips up Mount Ararat, very familiar with the area, and knows that Ed Davis has been there. He would describe certain places on the mountain, show pictures of them, and Ed Davis would say, yes, I remember that, and here's this, which is not on the slide, that's over here to the right. Here's what's on the left. Obviously, he had been there, and in some of the caves that they stayed in on the way up the mountain. he tells the story of saving the life of one of the chieftains of the Kurdish families and saving the life of his son. And as a reward showing hospitality and gratitude for saving the life of the son, the Kurdish village adopted him into their family. And as a part of the adoption ceremony at the end of the summer, on a particularly warm summer, carried him up and did show him the ark. He saw it. Now, it stormed as they approached. He couldn't get to within about 100 yards, but with army field glasses could examine it carefully. And it looks like what the others had seen. Here we see Alfred Lee, a commercial artist, worked with him, the same one that worked with Hagopian. And this is the picture that was drawn. By this time, it had broken in two, and glaciers moving can certainly do that. And we see on the right and on the left, the upper section of the picture, the two pieces and the broken ends that depict the ark as drawn by eyewitness Ed Davis. Now, we compare the pictures here, the one on the right in the lower right-hand corner, with the other three eyewitness accounts, and we see they're all very different from the old master accounts, the pictures that we might imagine, but very similar to each other. And notice particularly the picture that we see here that was in the lower right-hand corner, and the depiction on the right. We see debris flowing over the roof, and with the broken end showing the three decks sticking out from under that overflow. That's particularly significant. This is, of course, from ground level. In 1990, there was an overflight allowed by a helicopter in this area. It was they were just snapping pictures, looking at this particular canyon of interest because Ed Davis had identified it and correlated with George Hagopian's description. They came from different directions but reached the same place, evidently. They couldn't see it from the air, but they just snapped the photographs and came back home and looked carefully and actually didn't initially see it. But this is one of the photographs, and if we can go to full screen here, you won't see the ark, likely. But with the arrow, you can see this white roof with the broken end directly under the arrow. We'll do a closer view. And it gets a little bit fuzzy, but closer still, and we see the superstructure there in line with the arrow going back up under the debris. The arrow is on top of the debris that flows over the roof of the ark with that blunt broken end sticking out and that notch on top indicating the superstructure. You can almost see the striations on the roof going back up under the debris. Not National Geographic type quality, but certainly very, very interesting and dramatic. Just after that, actually 4 years after that, a friend of mine did go back up and without permits, very dangerously, he and one other fellow traveled with him, leaned over the edge of this canyon and took a photograph without being able to look, just a photograph, emptied the camera, shot all the rolls of film, came back home. Not as well focused as it ought to be, but notice, well, actually, let's do the comparison here of these two, which I think shows us what we're talking about. But this is what he saw when he leaned over the canyon and actually had a rope tied around his waist. His friend allowed him to go right to the edge, and this is what he photographed. I think I know what we're looking at here. I would like to go and find more and get clearer pictures, but this certainly justifies the conclusion that we need to go look, and there's good evidence that it is there. Perhaps even better evidence comes from satellite material. Unfortunately, it's highly classified. I have been told about it. I'm not allowed to look at it, but we have specific coordinates and we need to go look. And I'm part of a team that will be doing that hopefully soon if they quit shooting people over there. With the body count at 70,000, this is very similar to the Vietnam situation, and We have official permits. We actually have a lease on the mountain at this point, signed by the President of Turkey and the Department of Commerce. But the piece of paper is not worth a whole lot if you get shot. So we're hoping that things calm down and become more peaceable. This is the scene from the Russian side, looking at the area where the Ark is, right up at the edge of the Shenandoah, this huge gash in the side of the mountain. It's covered with snow, of course, in the wintertime. In the latter part of the summer, it melts back, but not completely at this point. I think it did 50-100 years ago. I think it's covered, and the satellite telemetry indicates, with about 60 feet of ice at this point. We'd have to go down through the ice. But that's why people have gone and haven't seen it and flown over and haven't seen it. It's under a 75 square mile permanent ice cap that never goes away. It's released in the edge of that. But I think very exciting evidence. It doesn't have to still be there. We could understand if it had been destroyed, but it would not surprise me, and I think we have very, very good evidence that it's there from eyewitness accounts, from satellite telemetry, and from photographs that we need to improve. Let's think about what the Bible says this means before we conclude. 2 Peter chapter 3, Peter was using the story of the flood account of the Ark of Noah to convince people that God will judge. And there's a lot of people today who don't think there's going to be a judgment. They don't even think twice about things they know the Bible condemns, and they know they haven't obeyed what the Bible says, and it doesn't bother them. God hasn't judged for a long time. And that proves in their mind, it seems, that God won't. Peter addresses that. Where's the promise of his coming? This is what they were saying. For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continued just as it was from the beginning of creation. They seem to be creationists, but they don't believe in judgment. Peter responds, answering that, when he says, they deliberately ignore this fact, that by the word of God, the heavens existed long ago, the earth was formed out of water, and by means of water, through which the world at that time was deluged with water and perished. You think God won't judge? What are you thinking about? He has judged. There's proof of it. In the mile and a half of sedimentary layers with billions and billions of dead things in it that cover the continents. In the plain scriptures that say specifically that all of the high mountains under all the heavens were covered. God did judge. He believes sin is serious, even though the world may laugh at it. You may think it's a joke, but God doesn't. The flood tells us very plainly that sin is serious. 2 Peter chapter 3 continues, the day of the Lord will come. Here's what this proves. He has judged and he will judge. When the heavens will pass away with a roar, the elements will be destroyed with intense heat. The earth and its works will be burned up. First time destroyed by water. Never do that again. But next time it's by fire. And that's when it'll be burned up. He says, which at some time were disobedient when once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah while the ark was preparing, wherein few, that is, eight souls, were saved by water. Which he continues to describe, saying, corresponding to that, baptism now saves you. Not the removal of dirt from the flesh, but an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Christ. Well, people laugh at that today, even religionists, as they laughed at Noah when he said, the judgment is coming and you need to get on the ark. Well, we tell people what God says, as Noah did, and people may laugh, but the plain word is still there and it'll face us in the day of judgment. I believe the story of the ark and Noah is real, and it tells us sin is serious and God will judge, but that he also provides mercifully for those who will humbly obey him. And we encourage you to do just that. The description of Noah's ark, the flood, that we find in Scripture has long been the atheist's favorite object of ridicule. We're told this is just an impossible story. It couldn't be historical, and yet it seems to be presented that way in Scripture. And many who believe the Bible will say, well, yes, I believe it, but this maybe was an allegory, but that's not the way it's presented in Scripture. And others will say, well, yes, I do believe it, but when they say so, they do it with without a lot of conviction. And sometimes in our minds it gets relegated to the category of the tooth fairy or Santa Claus, and it's just not really real in our minds. And I think we can show from the Bible, if you believe the Bible, as well as from scientific evidence, which is not going to be primarily our focus today, but there is a great deal, and we'll look at some. From these things, we can see that this is a real story and that the flood was real. Obviously, that's not the conviction of a good many people who claim to be Christians. For example, we find William Powers of SMU, who's professor of Old Testament history there, being interviewed just a few years ago when some reportedly had seen the ark on Mount Ararat. We'll talk more about that in a moment. What do you think about this, Mr. Powers? He says Noah's ark will be discovered about the same time as Jack's beanstalk is found. And then he says the whole notion of building in a week a boat big enough to hold and at the same time collecting two of every kind of animals is a formidable task. Well, he thinks somehow that the ark was built in 2 weeks, maybe, or in a week. Maybe he's confusing it with the creation week. Most people understand at least 120 years, Peter talks about, while the ark was preparing, was involved. And the idea of collecting, God didn't have Noah collect the animals. He had the animals come to him. And by the way, that's the reasonable place for migration to begin. And we see amazing capabilities of animals to go to specific places that we'd have a very difficult time duplicating. But this man obviously doesn't believe what it says. Many people will try to say, well, I believe the New Testament, but the Old Testament is just, maybe there's some allegory involved here. And I don't think that's a tenable position. Let's notice what we read in Matthew chapter 24. For the coming of the Son of Man will be just like the days of Noah. For as in those days which were before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying, giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark. Jesus is speaking of this as if these were historical days. And the argument that he's making here is that the coming of the Son of Man is going to be just like this. Now, if the days of Noah were mythological, what does that say about the coming of the Son of Man? It kind of messes up the argument, doesn't it? Peter obviously believed this. There are 14 references in the New Testament to the reality of the flood. We're looking at a couple of them. First from Jesus, then from Peter. And he refers to the skeptics who were saying that God's not going to judge. It's been a long time since he judged. They deliberately ignore this fact, Peter says, that by the word of God, the heavens existed long ago. The earth was formed out of water and by means of water, through which the world at that time was deluged with water and perished. Poor Peter, he thought this was real. And he used it as an argument to answer the naturalists of that day that say God's not going to judge. Actually, they weren't pure naturalists, but they were denying a coming judgment by evidence that God will judge from the fact he has judged. Now, proof that he's going to judge is indicated from the fact he has. But if he hadn't, and it's just a myth, Peter's argument just dissolves, doesn't it? I think Peter was telling the truth, and he made a good argument. As we look at the world around us, we look at history, we look at accounts of found by archaeologists, I believe we see abundant evidence for a worldwide flood. Funk and Wagnall refers to the deluge or the flood in their Dictionary of Folklore. a world cataclysm, Funkenwagnall says, which during which the world was inundated or submerged by water, a concept found in almost every mythology in the world. Now, he believes it's myth, but why do you find it in every culture? And we find flood traditions all over the world, 39 of different ones in North America, some from the various Indian tribes, some of them from the Eskimos, but the Cherokees have their view. Each of the Indian groups, or at least a number of them, have, well, 59 of them have flood traditions that give the core picture of eight people on an ark with animals that were saved while the world was destroyed. 46 of them from Central and South America, 31 from Europe, 17 have been documented from the Middle East, 23 from Asia, and then we find 37 of them from the Pacific Islands and Australia. When I was traveling in Australia, going to school there, I found one of the artisans selling a boomerang and looked at the carvings on it and asked them, what is this depicting? And they say, this is the story of the flood. And they had their characters, there were eight, that were on the ark, and here's the picture that was carved on the boomerang. Had nothing to do with the Bible. This was from their ancient traditions. Why do you have this in all of the cultures? I think there's a good explanation for it in a common experience in their historical background. Seashells on mountaintops, I think, are good evidence. It's entertaining to hear the geologists try to explain this, especially when we find, for example, on top of Mount Everest, Cambrian rocks. That's what's at the bottom of the geologic column. How did they get on top of Mount Everest? Where's the nearest Cambrian, where they could have come from? Well, it's all the way to North Africa. And so here's a huge block of rock, over a half mile thick, that was shoved from North Africa all the way to Nepal, and then a mountain grew under it, and that's how it got on top. Well, I think there are simpler explanations. We go to the Pyrenees, 7,000 feet, and we see seashells. Top of the Rocky Mountains, I collected this specimen with all kinds of seashells in it, right at a peak. In Bolivia, I collected these trilobites, which live at the bottom of the ocean, and then seashells at 14,500 feet. Was recently in Israel on top of Mount Nebo, from which we're told Moses was able to survey all of the land of Israel, and right up on top, yes, I found seashells, which is typical. I think there's a good, reasonable explanation for that, a better explanation than shoving a huge block of rock all the way from North Africa to Nepal with a mountain growing under it is a catastrophic global flood. As we look at the geologist's interpretation of the rock that we see covering the continents today, the views have changed dramatically in the last generation. In the 60s, even 70s, this uniformitarian, slow, gradual picture was dominant, and it's still in a lot of the textbooks. But notice the description by David Rapp, who's curator of the Chicago Field Museum, the largest fossil museum in the United States. He says a great deal has changed. He says contemporary geologists, that is, up-to-date, now modern geologists and paleontologists, now generally accept catastrophe as a way of life, although they avoid the word catastrophe. That sounds too much like maybe what the Bible is talking about. He says the 19th century idea of uniformitarianism and gradualism. Now, this is interesting that he describes it this way. Many people think this is the picture. Now, this was a 19th century idea, this idea of gradualism. It still exists, he says, in popular treatments of geology and in some museum exhibits and in lower level textbooks. And yes, it certainly does. But this is not the view held by contemporary paleontologists and geologists, though you find it in our state parks. For example, here is a fossil that's found at the Florissant Fossil Beds, the National Monument there, and a sign that says, remember, 2 inches equal 1 million years. Here's this slow, gradual buildup of the rocks. But think about that in terms of this fossil. If that were true, 2 inches equal 1 million years, then it would take 2,500 years to cover a human hair. Now, at that rate, what's going to happen to the spider as that slow, gradual process is taking place? This is just nonsense. It's not even very good nonsense. And the geologists have understood that. There are tons of reasons for believing that isn't true, and that's a 19th century idea that's been left behind by contemporary geologists. Robert Dott was president of the Society of Sedimentary Geology when he made his presidential address and said, I hope I have convinced you that the sedimentary record is largely a record of episodic events. Now, he avoids the word catastrophe, but he means the same thing. Catastrophic events, episodic events, rather than being uniformly continuous. He goes on to say, my message is that episodicity is the rule, not the exception. The rule, when you look at geology, is that this rock record did not happen slow and gradually. This happened catastrophically, episodic, I don't know what the word would be. It's episodic events, and episodicity is the rule, not the exception. We see an illustration of this kind of thinking with John Horner, who is the character that, the real life character that the fictional character in Jurassic Park is based on, the fellow who was digging fossils up, dinosaurs up in Montana. The real character is John Horner, and in his book, Digging Dinosaurs, he says, referring to a site there in Montana, there were 30 million fossil fragments. At a conservative estimate, we had discovered the tomb of 10,000 dinosaurs. Okay, this is not unusual. We find several places like this. How do you account for the tomb of 10,000 dinosaurs? Well, it got covered quickly. They were preserved beautifully. He said there was a flood. This was no ordinary spring flood from one of the streams in the area, but a catastrophic inundation. Now, he's not talking about Noah's flood. This would be the death knell for his career. But look at the strata. This is catastrophic. And that's the way he explains it. He said, that's our best explanation. It seems to make the most sense. And on the basis of it, we believe this was a living, breathing group of dinosaurs that were destroyed in one catastrophic moment. And when we look through the record, and of course we like to talk about the geologic evidence for a young age. We don't have time to go into a great deal of that. But one of the most obvious for a flood-type burial, when we see many of these huge animals buried and preserved beautifully, not at the rate of 2 inches per million years. And notice W.E. Swinson of the British Museum of Natural History, and he's quoting Steenberg, who was famous for finding the nodosaurs. These are these little Porsche-looking type animals with the tail, a hammer on the tail often, kind of like a turtle. Very curious type dinosaurs. He found hundreds of them, but all of them, he says, all the nodosaurs that he'd collected, observed in all the collections, were buried upside down. Now, if you were catching a bunch of turtles in a flood and they were all upside down, you could understand they got buried in a flood. The implication, they all drowned. Hundreds of examples like this demonstrate evidence for a universal flood, for the reality of the kind of catastrophic burial that produced the rock record. Evidence for the reality of this involves the testimony of Scripture, flood traditions worldwide, seashells on the mountaintops, burial of 10,000 in one place, upside down nodosaurs, and the neo-catastrophist revolution in geology. They don't change because they say, this would be nice to believe in catastrophes. They fight it tooth and toenail, but they've been pulled screaming and resisting into the concept that this was done catastrophically. This argues for the reality of a catastrophic flood. The reality, the conclusion is this flood was real. But it was not just the reality of a flood that we see evidenced. There is furthermore evidence that the flood was global. Many will say, well, yes, there must have been a flood, and we see floods today, and maybe 10,000 local floods is a good explanation of the geologic column. That doesn't work with what the Bible says or with the geologic evidence as well. The flood was global. Certainly, if you believe Scripture, we see Genesis uses 30 universal terms that emphasize the fact that it was global. Now, many times people will say, well, we believe the Bible. See, here's evidence of this local flood here at the Black Sea. And the Black Sea overflowed, and it was that part of the world, all the world that they knew about. That simply doesn't fly with what we read in Scripture. Genesis 6 and verse 13, God said to Noah, the end of not some flesh, but all flesh has come before me. Behold, I'm about to destroy them with the earth. And it's the earth as well as flesh that Genesis says was destroyed. I think the earth was eroded to a depth of over a mile, and then it was redeposited so that we have an average of a mile and a half of sedimentary rock covering the continents with billions and billions of dead things in it. All flesh with the earth was destroyed by this event. And then in chapter 7, he says, the water prevailed more and more upon the earth so that all the high mountains everywhere under the heavens were covered. How would he say that any clearer? All flesh that moved on the earth perished. Birds, cattle, beasts, every swarming thing that swarms upon the earth, all mankind. Now, the phrase all flesh, I think, is modified by what we see a little bit later. But it's certainly not a local phenomenon that he's talking about. I think the things in the flood didn't necessarily, that lived in the ocean didn't necessarily perish. Again, verse 21 of chapter 7, all flesh that moved on the earth perished, and cattle and beast, other places in whose nostrils are the breath of life, every swarming thing that swarms, but the every and the all pervade all of these descriptions. He blotted out every living thing upon the face of the land. Again, the qualification, on the land. From man to animals to creeping things to birds of the sky, they were blotted out from the earth. Only Noah was left together with those that were with him on the ark. Now, if we think about that for a minute, what was the need of an ark if this was a local flood? You just go over the next hill, and if one bird flew over the hill and wasn't destroyed here in the flood, then the description that we have is false, and the whole thing becomes a joke. It's just unnecessary. It is not a believable story, obviously, if that were the case. Now, sometimes people will say, well, this was the whole world at that time. Everybody was here in the Mesopotamian Valley, and that's the only world they knew about. And I think our evolutionary prejudices are controlling our thoughts about population. It took millions of years to get to where we are today, but when you study population dynamics, you see, no, it happened very quickly. If you look at this chart of flood population, you see in 80 years, you go from 3 billion to 9 billion. In 80 years, what happened 1,000 years ago? 2,000 years ago, you see where this line goes and how this is speaking of hundreds of years, hardly thousands of years. We see a challenge even there, but billions of years, hundreds of millions of years is not going to work. How many people were there on the earth at the time of the flood? Had you thought about that? Well, if you do some calculations, and you have to get rather sophisticated to talk about flood population growth, it takes a little bit of calculus. Looking at this formula, and we won't go into it in detail, I'll just refer you to some calculus books or some that might help you with the calculations. And you have to plug in the present or the population growth rate. The present growth rate is right at 2%. That gives us a much larger figure. But let's back up and be conservative. At less than half of the present population growth rate, two people for about 2,500 years from the creation to the flood produced 6 billion plus people. Same population we've got today. And of course, you start over with the population that we have today. Notice in Genesis 6, the earth was filled with violence, and so that's the reason God chose to bring the flood. It just doesn't fit when we try to say this is just a local area in the Mesopotamian Valley. And the real clincher, the killer to that concept is seen in the Rainbow Covenant, Genesis 9. I set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of a covenant between me and the earth. All right, what was the covenant between God and not just man, God and the earth, the whole earth? I will remember my covenant, and never again shall the water become a flood to destroy all flesh. Was there ever a local flood after this? Was he talking about local floods when he said never again? We see local floods all the time, don't we? It makes God a liar to say this was a local flood. When we look at the sedimentary rock record, which we love to talk about, what we're looking at is an average of a mile and a half of sedimentary rock, that's rock laid down by water, that covers the continents with billions and billions of dead things in it. Now, think, billions and billions of dead things in rocks laid down by water all over the world. That sounds much more like judgment than it does an evolutionary progression, and more obviously when we see that evolutionary progression doesn't fit the rock record. The founders of the discipline of geology all understood this. Notice Nicholas Steno, who's referred to as the father of modern stratigraphy. He's a hero in the geology textbooks. You'll have to memorize his axioms if you want to past stratigraphy. Here is a quote from Dott and Batten, their textbook Evolution of the Earth. Steno's axioms provide ultimate basis of practically all interpretation of Earth history, so their importance can hardly be overemphasized. He figured out how to do stratigraphy 300 years ago and wrote the rules, the axioms that you have to memorize, and if you don't know them, you can't pass stratigraphy. They work. They explain what we have today. We still use those rules, and that's why he's touted as a hero. What they don't tell you is what's indicated here in this early edition of his book that I saw when I was doing work at Cambridge in England, there in the Trinity Library. His book was dedicated to the proof of the Noachian deluge. This is what he thought explained it. In fact, just recently, last year in geology, we have this quote, Nicholas Steno believed in the universal flood throughout his life. This is his view of what happened. Based on Steno's initial work and other scientists after him, in the early 60s, we have the book Genesis Flood published by Morrison Whitcomb, who explained what we now know about geology in terms of a flood. Does this explanation fit? John C. McCampbell, who at the time was professor and head of the Department of Geology at the University of Southeastern Louisiana, a well-known geology school, wrote the foreword to this book, and he is an evolutionist, but he acknowledges that the facts of geology do fit in the foreword to the book, that the authors have built a very strong case for this interpretation and a serious challenge to the picture that's normally presented by the evolutionist. Now, he didn't say their view works, our view doesn't, but it wasn't far from that. But the idea that it just doesn't explain flies in the face of the fact that with this view, Nicholas Steno wrote the rules that we still use, and John C. McCampbell says, yes, the facts do fit, and they presented a serious challenge to ours. It's the uniformitarian view, certainly, that doesn't fit. I think one of the strongest arguments for a universal flood from geology is in the fact that we have global layers that surround our Earth. Now, not all of them are global, and a catastrophic flood wouldn't produce uniform layers all over the world, but if you find some of them that are global, you see some events certainly were virtually worldwide at the time this catastrophe took place. We'll look at the description by Derek Ager. Derek Ager is a dyed-in-the-wool evolutionist. He believes in evolution. Well, he's an atheist, and he hates the creationist and says so very plainly. So he's not trying to make a creationist argument, but he's acknowledging the nature of the stratigraphic record and saying, here's a problem we have. And he describes a layer that surrounds the world. So he says, I was taken by a Turkish friend to visit a cliff section in the Upper Cretaceous sediments near a site on the Black Sea coast. Now here's the Black Sea in Turkey, and he's looking at this particular layer. He says, describing this, I saw the familiar white chalk of Northwest Europe with the black flints and the old fossil friends such as Macraster and Echinoroids. Here are unique fossils, black flints, two particular types of fossils that he says are peculiar to this layer. It's a Cretaceous chalk, a very unique consistency. This is a layer you can recognize with flints and with specific fossils. He continues saying, what I saw was the familiar white chalk, and then he says it was identical to the white cliffs of Dover in England and the rolling plateau of Picardy in France, and then the quarries in southern Sweden and the cliffs of eastern Denmark. He continues saying, we've long known, of course, the white chalk facies of Cretaceous times extended all the way from Atrium in Northern Ireland via England, Northern France, the low countries of Northern Germany, Southern Scandinavia, to Poland, to Bulgaria, eventually to Georgia, and south to the Soviet Union. We also knew the same facies in Egypt and in Israel. This continues globally, and we're not through yet. Looking at the description that he has, but we'll show you pictures from Israel in a moment. Nevertheless, there's even worse to come, for on the other side of the Atlantic in Texas, we find the Austin chalk of the same age and character as found in Arkansas and Mississippi and Alabama, the same Austin chalk. Now, studying geology in Texas, we know all about the Austin chalk, but this is what he's talking about in Scandinavia, in Egypt, in Israel, in France, in England, and all across the United States. He continues saying they've found this in Alabama, most surprising of all, much further away still in Western Australia. The same black flints, the same familiar fossils, resting as in Northwest Europe on glauconic sands, the same layer underneath it, and then this consistent chalk with the same flints, the same fossils. That is global. Now, this is not that which is produced by a local flood. Then he concludes saying, some general explanation surely is needed for such a widespread distribution of a unique fossil facies. This is unique, it's easy to recognize, and it's around the world. We got to have an explanation. We need an explanation, but they don't have one. I think we have one very obviously. Recently in Europe, in Israel, we see this layer. This is what I would call the Austin chalk in Texas. This is a global layer, and we find it worldwide. And so when we look at evidence for the global extent of the flood, we see the testimony of Scripture, every high hill under all the heavens. Population dynamics says the earth was filled at that time and all life was destroyed. We see a mile and a half of sedimentary deposit covering the continents on the average, and this global extent of layers, all of which point very conclusively, I believe, to the idea that the flood was global, that this was not 10,000 local floods that produced this. That just doesn't fly when we look at all of the evidence.